place for people. People that need help, and that's all of us at one time or another. We need different kinds of help, maybe. GODTEL is not primarily a place to give people a roof over their head and food to eat. GODTEL is a place whereby we can tell people about Jesus Christ. GODTEL is a school. It's my school. It's my wife's school. It's a place whereby we can learn how to minister to people, how to love people, sometimes people that are unlovable. And all the people that cooperate in this effort get to be part of what's going on at GODTEL.
Too bad they have to grow up. They're wonderful while they're little. They do just what kids do. But then when they grow up sometimes, they still do what kids do. Well, here we are. It's Monday night. We had a little break in the heat. Aren't y'all happy? I'm not, but you can be happy. I like hot weather. I like watching young people when we're out working on a new building falling out while us old people just keep on working. Our building contractor, Danny, he's 75. My brother's 49 was working for him, and last week Danny worked him into the ground. That was so amazing. Richard finally said, I can't work for him anymore. It's too hot out there, you know. And the 75-year-old man's out there just working and working and working. Pretty amazing to me. Well, we're in 1 John chapter 3, verse 13. And this is a continuation of last week. The expressions of love, starting in verse 13. And I want you to know that five times in this chapter, he says and uses the phrase, you know, or ye know, you know. You're supposed to know some things. Marvel not, my brethren, if the world hate you. We know that we have passed from death into life because we love the brethren. He that loves not his brother abides in death. Whosoever hates his brother is a murderer, and you know that no murderer has eternal life abiding in him. Hereby perceive we the love of God, because he laid down his life for us, that we ought to lay down our lives for the brethren. But whoso has this world's good and sees his brother have need and shuts up his bowels of compassion from him, how dwells the love of God in him? My little children, let us not love in word, neither in tongue, but in deed and in truth. And hereby we know that we are of the truth and shall assure our hearts before him. For if our heart condemn us, God is greater than our hearts and knows all things. Beloved, if our hearts condemn us not, then we have confidence toward God. Whatsoever we ask, we receive of him, because we keep his commandments and do those things that are pleasing in his sight. He that keeps his commandments dwells in him, and he in him. And hereby we know that he abides in us by the Spirit which he has given us. Let's go back to verse 13. Marvel not. Don't give it another thought. Don't get excited. Don't take it to heart. Don't take it personally when the world hates you if you're a Christian. The world is going to hate you. And we've gotten by for a couple hundred years in America without too many problems, but it's coming our way. Over in the Middle East right now, Christians and Jewish people are being slaughtered by the ISIS and the other groups, you know, that are radical Muslims. They hate Christians. They hate Jewish people. Christianity is the fulfillment of Judaism. They hate us. And it's amazing because Jesus told us already that this is the way it would be. He told us in the Gospel of John, he said, they hated me first. They're going to hate you too. So don't take it to heart. I remember one time years ago when some people, I was a young preacher, you know. A lot of people don't know that I ever was young, a young preacher. But I was, and some people said some ugly things about me. And I went to my pastor, and I was feeling pretty low. And I said, how come they're talking like that about me? Why are they saying all those ugly things? They weren't even true things. They're just ugly things. And he says, oh, son, he says, they don't hate you. They hate Jesus, but they can't talk to him. So they take it out on you. Oh, okay. That cheered me up a lot. The world hates us. The sign on that back wall, we have it on all three missions. Those that live godly in Christ Jesus shall suffer persecution. And if you're a Christian and you're not suffering persecution, there's only two things that it could be. One, you're not living godly. Or two, you just ain't gotten the right place at the right time yet. But you will. Just hang around and it'll happen. We don't look for it, but it does happen. We know that we have passed from death into life. The proof. Because we love the brethren. Doesn't say we like them. Says we love them. We treat them right. He that loves not his brother abides in death. These are other Christians. Thank God that Christianity has nothing to do with the way we feel. If I responded by the way I felt, there'd be dead bodies all around me. And people don't understand this. I don't have to like you. Let's just make it easy. I don't like you. I don't like my wife sometimes. Don't like myself when I look in the mirror. Don't like my cat. Don't like my children, grandchildren, great-grandchildren. But I do know that I am responsible to God to love them. So I have to treat them right in spite of how I feel. And you know, the average man and woman, if they would just learn that lesson, they could stay married forever. But most are too selfish. They want to do what they want to do. So we have passed from death into life, and we love the brethren. In chapter 3, verse 2, the same chapter, it says, beloved, now we are the children of God. It does not yet appear what we shall be. But we know when Jesus comes back, he'll change the way we look, and we'll look like we're supposed to. But right now we are the children of God. So since right now we're the children of God, right now we're supposed to act like the children of God. And that means I have to love you and treat you right when I don't want to. Now, this was brought home to me again. God's always teaching me little lessons. Saturday, I was working all Saturday morning trying to get my truck in Livingston back on the road. Hurried up, got the brakes done and everything, got it back on the road. Locked the shop up so I could get over after lunch with Josh because we're working on a new album, which we were playing part of earlier today. And we've got this new album coming out, and so I was trying to get done with some songs. And I start heading across the street from my house to where the studio is, and there was a guy in the parking lot. He didn't look very nice. In fact, he looked kind of mean, pretty big fella. And there he was with his car, and the hood opened up. I just wanted to just like wave and go on by. But the Lord said, you need to see what he needs. Sometimes the Lord just wants you to be willing. That's all he requires sometimes. That was one of these times. I went over there, even though I didn't want to. I said, sir, I see you got your hood up. Do you need some help? He says, no. He says, my car overheated a little. And he said, I'm just waiting for it to cool down. I said, well, do you need some water? We can get you some water. No, I got water. I just need it to cool down a little bit before I can put it in. And I was very grateful. Inside myself, I went, yes. Because it could have been something else. He could have had a broken fan belt. He could have had a broken radiator hose or something else. My shop's right across the street. I got lots of radiator belts, lots of fan belts. Probably could have fixed him up. But I was so glad I didn't have to go unlock the shop and do all that when I'm trying to work on this album project. But God wanted me to be willing. So if he had a need, I would have done what I would have just done it. Because that's what you're supposed to do. Christians don't come first. They come last. Always. That's why Jesus said, if you want to be my disciple, you had to pick up your cross, follow me, and deny yourself. I didn't want to deny myself, but I was willing. And that's all God wanted that day. He just wanted me to make the choice to be willing. When I got out of working on the album about several hours later, of course, the fellow was gone. I may never see him again. But the whole point is, if you're a Christian, you have to be willing to die to self. You don't get to do what you want to do. Sometimes God allows us to do some of the things we want to do. That's like icing on the cake. But that's not what we live for. Our purpose in life is to somehow show Jesus to other people. And sometimes it's just a helping hand. Had a guy one time came in our mission. I've told this story here before, but I keep repeating it because everybody keeps changing. I don't have to have too many illustrations that way. Martin Mary heard him also. You can always tell when I'm telling an illustration Martin's heard, his eyes glaze over and he kind of falls asleep. It's a dead giveaway when you look over and he's going. He doesn't really do that, but makes a good story. This guy comes in our mission, and we checked him in, let him stay. But he's there a couple of 3 days, maybe. Finally, one day, I'm standing down there in our Bible study here, and he comes over to me, and he says, Preacher, he said, do you like me? I said, no. That's just the easy thing to say, because it's the truth. No. He says, well, how come you let me stay here? I said, because it's the right thing to do. And you don't like me? I said, no, I don't like you. I don't even like myself. He said, but what, you let me eat here. I said, yeah, that's what God told me to do. And you don't feel anything for me? I said, I'm starting to, but you won't like it. Because he was agitating me. He said, well, you know, I don't think it's right. He says, if you're going to house and feed people, you ought to like them. You ought to have some feelings. And like is an emotion. And that's why a lot of people can't stay married, because one day, they call it love, but it's really, I like you, and then I don't like you anymore because you didn't do something I wanted, because you burnt the coffee, you know, or something. Boy, if that was the case with my wife and I, we never would have made it 43 years. Because I know that women are nuts. I've talked to a lot of men about their wives, and we all agree. Of course, the women probably agree about something else, but they won't tell us because it would make us cry. We'd hurt, you know. Finally, I looked at the fellow. I said, you know what? You need to quit worrying about how I feel and be glad that we're putting food on the table for you to eat. If you walk in that door over here, do you want me to go, I love you, or do you want to blow beans when you're hungry? Now, if you're smart, you'll take the beans, because all the I love yous in the world will never fill your stomach. You read the Gospels, and it's a very amazing truth. All the words that Jesus spoke, he never once looked at anybody and said, I love you. Did he love them? Of course he did. He died and paid the penalty for their sin. You can't express love in any greater way than that. But you see, we live in this politically correct society where everybody wants words. Words don't get it, folks. It's actions. There was two boys in the Bible. The daddy come to him and says, son, go work in my field today. And the son said, okay, but he didn't go. He came to the second one and he said, go work in my field. He said, no, I ain't going out in your crummy old field. I ain't going out there. But then he felt bad about it and he went. And Jesus asked this question, which one did the will of the Father? It was the one that went. Not the one that said he would go, but didn't go. But we live in a world where people want to hear the words, and they're just not very bright. I don't care how you talk. Just treat me right. And when it's dinner time, let me know. You know? So, don't get too excited, folks. We've passed from death into life, and the proof of that is by the way we treat other people. Whosoever hates his brother is a murderer, and you know that no murderer has eternal life abiding in him. This is what some used to be. Some people hate in their heart. That's as bad as murder from God's point of view. Some people have actually physically murdered people. You can repent of those sins, get saved, and go to heaven. God doesn't judge you for what you used to be. He judges your heart for what you are. And all of us used to be something that we're probably not too proud about, you know. Hereby perceive we the love of God, because he laid down his life for us. So the love of God. Now, it's interesting, and I've told you before in the Gospels of John, and in John here, 1 John, he always gives some reference to the divinity of Christ. Well, here it is in this verse. He says, God died for us. Isn't that amazing? Well, somebody says, I thought Jesus died for us. That's the whole point. He is God. John 1:1, where it's all started. In the beginning was the Word was with God, the Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God, all things were made by Him. And that Word that was God, with God, in the beginning, in verse 14, became flesh and dwelt among us, and we saw Him as Jesus Christ, the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. But here it's obvious. He says, hereby perceive we the love of God, because He laid down His life for us. And we ought to lay down our lives for the brethren. Now, there's religions out there that don't believe this. They don't believe that Jesus was God. So they have a problem with this verse. But whoso has this world's goods and sees his brother has a need and then shuts up his bowels of compassion, like if I had walked by that guy the other day and I have the capacity to help him, but then I say, I'm not going to do it. And I just walk on. Start singing a song, walk on. But you see, the Spirit of God within me convicted me that was not the right. That's what I wanted to do. Wasn't the right thing to do. And you see your brother has a need and you shut up your bowels of compassion. You say no. Then how dwells the love of God in you? How can you say you're a Christian if you turn your back on those in need? The other day, Joseph, last Wednesday, as I come down off the highway, he was standing by the truck. I could see the back of it was jacked up, so I knew it wasn't going anywhere. And Joseph was there, and my first impulse was just wave and go on by. It was my first impulse, because I figured you got yourself in some kind of trouble. You need to get yourself out of it. But you saw how far up the road I got. God convicted me. I had to get over and I had to back up quite a ways. Get back where to make sure you were okay and everything. But, so, you know, the flesh doesn't want to stop and help anybody. It really doesn't. The flesh wants to do its thing. I'm important. I got stuff to do, man. I can't be wasting my time on you. That's what the flesh says. Then the Spirit of God says, okay, son, pull that rig over. Now back up. Put a smile on your face. Go see what Joseph needs. I was fortunate again. Martin was out getting him a tire. Of course, I did give him Joseph a little lecture when I found out they didn't have a spare because the spare had gone flat. I said, Joseph, you're driving this truck. It's your responsibility to make sure there's a spare there. It's not Martin's responsibility. It's yours. You're driving a truck. I hope he never forgets that. Because the next time it has, I'm going to say, I told you so, and then I am going to drive by. In fact, I'll just roll down the window and yell, I told you so! My little children, let us not love in word. Man, back in the 1980s, especially in our churches, the people were going through this stuff. You go in, everybody's wanting to hug each other. I'm not a hugger. I don't want to hug other men's wives. I don't really like to hug the guys, and these days you don't want to because they'll think you're kind of funny. But they were going through this thing, I love you, man, in Jesus. And then you didn't see them all week long. And I'd go and preach in churches and some large churches and all these people, and there are hundreds of people, and they didn't even know each other. They're supposed to be brothers and sisters in the Lord. They don't even know each other's names. You got all the doctors sitting in one spot. All the lawyers sitting in one spot. The plumbers are all sitting in one spot. If there's any Indian chiefs, you could find him. He's around with the other Indian chiefs. There are all these little cliques, all these little groups, you know. And people don't even know each other. And I'm going, what is with this, you know? When Nancy and I, Martin and Mary, we were all members of Fredonia Baptist Church. It was a pretty good-sized church. I tried to get to know everybody. I just walk up and start talking to people, you know. And some of them acted like it was an inconvenience. That's amazing to me. And one old lady one time, I'm sure she's passed away now because this was 40 years ago. But I came into church and I just sat down. I was waiting, you know, and she come over to me. This really happened in our church. She came over to me and she had this big old purse. I remember that. And she says, Johnny, You're sitting in my seat. I was afraid she was going to hit me with the purse. So I got it moved. And I thought to myself later, I wonder what people who come to visit the church think when somebody comes up to them and says, you're sitting in my seat. We got our little church in Livingston, and we've got certain people that come, and they always sit in the same seat. And man, you better not get in their seat. They get upset. Some of the ladies, their faces turn red, and it's not from makeup. Looks more like make down to me. I mean, they do. They get in this rut, you know. Even some of our employees, they sit in the same seat every time. And Nancy's telling people, don't sit there. That's Benita's seat. Don't sit there. That's Greg's seat. Don't sit there. You know, that's, well, my sister's not there now. She's sitting in the same seat all the time, too. And, you know, I like a little variety myself. You know, I try out a few different chairs, see if they feel any different. They don't, but we do that. We're like that. We're creatures of habit, you know. Martin sits in the same seat every Monday night. Every Monday night. I got to get me a whoopee cushion. I want to put one over there in his seat when he's not looking. Watch him jump back out of that seat. We are supposed to love one another and do it in truth. Hereby we know that we are of the truth and shall assure our hearts before God. Excuse me. If our hearts condemn us, God is greater than our heart. This is about repentance. We can actually know that our heart condemned us. If we're a Christian, it will. If you're a lost person, nothing will happen. You just do your thing. But if our heart condemn us, then we can go to the Lord. He's greater than our heart. He knows all things. And if our heart doesn't condemn us, then we're doing, obviously, what we're supposed to be doing. If I'm driving through a school zone and it's 20 miles an hour, and I'm going 20 miles an hour, I don't care how many police officers are there. But if I'm going 40 in that 20 mile an hour, I better look around. My heart will probably condemn me because I know it's wrong. So if our heart condemns us not, then we have confidence toward God. And whatsoever we ask, we receive of him. Now, a lot of preachers, they like to stop with that part of the verse. Oh boy, God will give you anything you ask for right there. Boy, there it is right there in black and white. Uh-huh. But they forget to read the rest of it and read it in context. Because we keep his commandments. What did Jesus say in John 14, 15? If you love me, keep my commandments. Do what I say. That's why sometimes I look at people when they don't keep the rules that God tells them. I say, you hate me. I don't hate you, brother. Yeah, you hate me. How come you say that? Well, because we found a can of beer in your room under your bed. That's how come. You agreed not to drink while you were here, and you're drinking while you're here. You hate me. I had one guy almost in tears one day when I told him that, oh, man, because he had a bottle of whiskey up there we found. And we didn't know who it belonged to because there was three different guys in the room and nobody would confess. So I came up to the podium and I had my suit coat on and I had that whiskey bottle hanging out of my pocket and I had my collar all messed up. And I staggered up to the podium. I kept watching everybody and I started slurring my speech and everything. And then I finally looked at you guys and I said, there's three guys in here that hate me. I'm holding that bottle up there, you know. They hate me. And I said it about four times, and finally the guy who owned the bottle couldn't take it anymore. And he said, Brother June, I'm sorry. It's mine. I'll never do it again. Oh, I said, no, you hate me. I said, man, if you want to drink, that's your business. Go somewhere and do it. Leave me alone. But when you come in here and agree to go by the rules and you don't do it, it's because you hate me. I'm not talking about words. I'm talking about actions. You can say you love me all day long, but if you break the rules, you hate me. Or Martin, whoever the case may be. Also, according to chapter 5, verse 14, you can only ask God for what is within his will. We're going to cover that in a couple of weeks. But it has to be within God's will. You can't just ask God for stuff and expect it to show up. Now, the TV preachers sometimes will tell you that, some of them. It's a lie. You can't just say, well, you know, I want to be a Viper today. Those are getting old. I want me a new BMW sports model. Maybe a Porsche. The Roadster. The one that goes fast. And God, while you're giving me that Roadster, would you do me a favor and put me a middle-aged blonde in the front seat, about 25? You know, God's not going to do that. That's not His will for your life. I had a lady come in our place one day and she says, Brother Jim, pray for me. I said, what for? She says, I want to know when it's God's will for me to leave my husband. I said, what? I want to know when it's God's will for me to leave my husband. I said, what's going on here? Is your husband committing adultery? Oh, no. Is your husband don't work and won't support you and the kids? Oh, no. He supports us. He has a good job, makes good money. Well, does he treat the kids bad? Oh, no. He loves the kids. He treats them really good. Well, is he beating on you? No, he never touched me. He never beats on me or anything. I said, why you want to leave a man like that? She said, he's boring. Boring? Lord help us. We need a little more boring. I couldn't believe this lady. I'm going to leave her husband because he's boring. She was wanting a little excitement in her life. And I'm probably reasonably sure this happened some years ago. She probably found some and probably wished she hadn't. I don't want to fool with her anymore. So we keep His commandments, and we do those things that are pleasing in His sight. We are doers of the Word of God, not hearers only. And this is His commandment, that we should believe on the name of His Son, Jesus Christ, and love one another as He gave His commandment. He that keeps His commandments dwells in Him, and God in Him, and hereby we know that He abides in us by the Spirit which He has given us. About 40-something years ago, before GODTEL, I was preaching in a little church out in what's we call North Redlands, north of Nacogdoches, Mount Zion, CME Church. And there was an old man in there. He was about 80. And we were outside, and so I wanted to talk to him. And he was, you know, he looked like he had one foot on a banana peel and the other one in the grave. I didn't tell him that, but I did tell him. I said, sir, you're old. You're going to die. What are you doing to prepare yourself to meet Jesus? And he looked at me and he says, well, I'm working the works of God. I said, that's great. What are they? Man, he got the strangest look on his face. He said, you know, I've been a member of this here church all my life, and everybody says you got to do the works of God, but ain't nobody ever told me what they were. I said, well, I will. And I opened my Bible to John chapter 6, verse 29. The disciples asked Jesus, they said, Lord, what must we do to work the works of God? Same question. Jesus said, believe on Him that God has sent. Here it is again. This is His commandment, that we should believe on the name of Jesus Christ. And the proof that we're believing and trusting Jesus for our salvation is that we love one another. Remember what Jesus told that nice young man when He said, what are the greatest commandments? Jesus said, love the Lord your God with all your heart, your mind, your soul, and strength. And the second one is like unto the first. Love your neighbor as you love yourself. I love myself pretty darn good. Friday was our anniversary. Boy, did we have a day. What an evening we had. My wife and I looking into each other's eyes. Been married 42 years. We could barely see, but we looked into each other's eyes. And then she says, you know what we're going to have for dinner tonight? I said, no, what? She said, ice cream. So we had ice cream for dinner. I love my wife. She's so good to me. Had coffee ice cream and peanut brittle ice cream or some kind of toffee ice cream with chocolate syrup. I'm still kind of upset because we had whipped cream in the refrigerator and she didn't give me any, but I'll get it when we get home. But then it was a big bowl. Ate that ice cream up. Then she looked at me and she says, "Would you like some more?" Well, I know what she was up to, but I went along with it because I wanted some more. She got me so full on ice cream, I wasn't going to bother her the rest of the night. She knew that. The next day she said, "What do you want for dinner?" I said, "I don't know, but it ain't going to be ice cream." I had had enough of that. The works of God are to love the Lord your God with all your heart, your mind, your soul, and your strength. And the proof of that is that you love your neighbor like you love yourself. We're to love our wives. We're to love the brethren. We're to love our neighbors. We love ourselves, Romans 13. And we're even supposed to love our enemies. I certainly don't like them, for sure. But I got to treat them right anyway. One guy said one time, "Yeah, the Bible says if your enemy is thirsty, give him a drink." I said, "Yeah, drown the sucker." Well, that's not what God meant. You're supposed to treat people properly. And it has nothing to do with the way you feel. It is an expression of love. Words do not express love. They define love. But we've turned it around and call that our expression of love. "I love you," slap, 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 slap. You know, there's a lot of men that do that. I've had to do counseling with men that beat up their wives. "Oh, preacher, I don't know why I beat her up. I love her." I said, "No, you don't." "Well, yes, I do." "No, you don't." "Yes, I do." "No, you don't." "Yes, I do." "No, you don't." And I want you to know I got more "no, you don'ts" than they got "yes, I do's." And this one guy looked at me finally, and his wife was just, I mean, she was like hamburger meat. He just worked her over. He says, "How do you know I don't love her?" I said, "I can see it's written all over her face." Love isn't destructive towards another person. Love is kind and patient. Love seeks the best for others. Sometimes it seeks better for others than you get for yourself. I didn't say I like that. I just said it's the truth. If you want to love someone, then you need to show it by the way you act. That's why I said 2 weeks ago, I said, never say you love God more than anything, because none of us do. There's always something that comes up in our lives that kind of throws a monkey wrench in our love, you know. I love God, but I won't say I love him more than anything because I don't know what's going to come up tomorrow. Something might come up, distract me, you know, for a while. Of course, I'll get back on track, but it does happen. Our Father, thank you for loving each one of us the way you do. You loved us so much that you were willing to die and pay the penalty for our sin. You loved us so much and demonstrated it by raising from the dead to give us life. Abundant life. Whole life. Real life. Not the shadow of life that we experience down here without Christ. In fact, without Christ, we don't even know what life is. But with Christ in our heart, we begin to understand it. The Bible tells us in John 3:36, that if Christ lives in you, you have life. If he doesn't, you don't have life. The wrath of God abides on you. In other words, you're just waiting for judgment. So we thank you, Father, for this chapter. We thank you for John who wrote it, inspired by your Spirit, so that we could know the truth. We could actually know something. And we thank you for that. Of course, my prayer is and hope is that the folks in here are listening so the Christians can grow and become more like Jesus, conformed a little bit more to the image of Christ. And so maybe lost people can figure out that they're missing something in their life. The goal in life as a Christian is to live what God's Word says so that we can learn how to be content. It's not about stuff. We thank you for your Word and ask you to bless it tonight. In Jesus' name, amen.